Eastern on Book TV on C-SPAN 2.
In his essay on the justice of roosting chickens, University of Colorado professor Ward Churchill referred to those killed in the World Trade Center on September 11th as Little Eichmanns. Next, he addresses the resulting controversy and his views on U.S. foreign policy. This is an hour, 20 minutes.
All right. It's my honor tonight to introduce a man who's been at the forefront of movements for justice here in the U.S. for years. A vital figure in both activist and scholarly circles, Ward Churchill is professor of American Indian Studies at the University of Colorado Boulder. He is a member of the Leadership Council of Colorado AIM, the American Indian Movement, and past national spokesperson for the Leonard Peltier Defense Committee. He is a prolific writer and lecturer, and has authored, co-authored, or edited more than 20 books, including tonight's focus on the justice of roosting chickens, and the new book on City Lights, Kill the Indian, Save the Man, which are both available in the lobby. And three forthcoming AK Press books, Speaking Truth in the Teeth of Power, Globalization, Colonization, and Native North America, Cages of Steel, The Politics of Imprisonment, and Confronting the Crime of Silence, Evidence of U.S. War Crimes in Indochina. Please join me in welcoming the man who in the past month and a half has had the distinct honor of having his work and writings denounced by two U.S. governors, one House of Representatives, and none other than Fox News' own Bill O'Reilly. Here to set the record straight tonight is Ward Churchill.
Oseju. Hello, my relatives. It's good to see you here. It's an honor to be here. I bring you greetings from the elders of the Kutua Band of Cherokee, my people. From the Colorado chapter of the American Indian Movement, of which I've been a part since 1980, which you can see on C-SPAN if you want to tune into the University of Colorado speech that was given pretty much at the beginning of this nonsense. And from Gwarthy Las, otherwise known as Leonard Peltier, who tonight, as I speak to you, continues to sit in a cage at a federal prison, Leavenworth, Kansas, not for anything anyone, including even his prosecutor, has been willing to say at any point in the last 20 years at least that they believe he actually did, but rather as a symbol of the arbitrary ability of the federal government of the United States to repress the legitimate aspirations to liberation of indigenous people within its claim boundaries and put the emphasis on claim. There's a difference between a claim and a reality. I want to thank the people who organized this event for doing so. AK, City Lights, KPFA, everybody that was involved. And I want to pay a little recognition before we go on. My hero is here, Yuri Kochiyama, sitting right here in front. This book, the one they don't talk about, in preference for the unannotated blog version of things, it was written from the gut on 9/11 itself, and posted on 9/12. This book, the one that carries the full weight of what it was I was trying to say, is dedicated to Yuri. And there's a reason for that. Most consistent person in struggle that I've encountered in my entire lifetime. I draw inspiration from you, Auntie. I thank you for all your efforts over the years. Make some other recommendation. Commendation, perhaps. As was mentioned, we're blessed tonight with media. Oh, yes. Been trying for 20 years to get the attention of the media onto some actual content issues. One phrase. They've managed one phrase out of the entire book. Maybe it's because they can't read, you suppose? And this one, I actually want to break it down for you before the fact. There is a note, I think it's note 318, that is probably a problematic interpretation. It makes reference to people at Phoenix Indian School beating a young man to death. In actuality, what it says in a text that I cite in there, that they beat him into unconsciousness, he went into the infirmary and later died. I know it's a weighty issue. And that's exactly what's going on. See, they don't charge you, ultimately, with what it is they're after you for. They don't charge you with sedition. They don't charge you with treason. They don't charge you with incitement. They charge you with, having a lid of dope in your back pocket. They charge you with pedophilia. They charge you with things that sound kind of unsavory, and that's the nature of the process. Technically, yesterday, the issue was won. They conceded on the issues of academic freedom and First Amendment. Don't be deceived. This is backfill. They're trying to make a case on pretext to accomplish the same result and make it seem as if it was all on the up and up. But they've had a lot of help in doing that. The power hitters that came up and announced he should be fired for making a statement that you understood to be the truth, consistent with your rights under the First Amendment of the United States, consistent with your obligations under the rubric of academic freedom, consistent with your obligations as well as a human being, to speak truth, not to power. I never speak truth to power. Power never listens. Power knows everything I'm going to say better than I do. Power could teach me lessons about the mechanics of how it works. No, I never speak truth to power. I speak truth to you as I see it. I speak truth to people in the teeth of power. And that's the only truth I know how to speak. But the help they've gotten has been from the media. Charlie Brennan, are you here? Please stand up and take a bow, because you're a primary hitter in this. Spent the morning talking to an ex-wife right here in San Francisco. Yeah, hi, Charlie. Having a nice day now? My turn. I got the high ground. It's our interview, the one that you said you might be willing to do. Are you still beating your wife, Charlie? Answer yes or no, please. And remember, I got 9 people that hate your guts that are going to comment on whatever it is you have to say. Charlie, you and my colleagues at the faculty at the University of Colorado at Boulder, the purport to be white, I want to see the proof. I want to see you haven't got a log in a wood pile back there someplace, Charlie Brennan. And you purport to be a man. You purport to be a man. You've never purported to be anything else, and yet only one of your parents was, and you know it. You're a mixed blood man. Play these games, and how does it feel to be called out in public and put on that kind of an idiotic spot and call it journalism? Well, I'm practicing a journalistic trade now, and I expect a job at the Rocky Mountain News when I get back. Speak a little truth. Speak a little truth. I identified myself as being Kutuwa Band Cherokee. Let me put that as just straight up Cherokee. Why am I Kutuwa Band Cherokee? Because my grandmother told me I was. Why am I Cherokee? Because my mother told me I was. So I got to tell you this little story that comes with this. See, it's been in the Denver papers. I invented an identity, one guy says, and gets quoted, in order to get a job as an academic, although I didn't come into the university as an academic. I invented an identity at about the same time, which would be in the late 1970s, in order to sell my art, says another guy, quoted in the same source. I'm inventing identities all over the place for various purposes. All these things are treated as credible. And yet in that very same paper, they're quoting people who I went to high school with, who recall me identifying as American Indian clear back then. Well, high school, I moved to that town and that little class of 55 students in the 6th grade, so that puts me about 10 years old identifying, and I have to confess, I'm going to make true confessions here tonight, see? At 10 years of age, and actually a little earlier, I was sitting around in an all-white chunk of the country where it wasn't very popular to be Indian, crafting an Indian identity for myself so that sometime 20 years in the future, I could con a hiring committee at the University of Colorado, composed solely of Indians, as I recall, to give me a job for every bit of $12,000 writing grants to bring Indians into the university. It was a long con, as they published in the paper. As a child, I was hatching this one solely for the purposes of deceiving the Regents, and my colleagues at the University of Colorado would research fraud, and what my identity would have to do with that is a little bit mysterious, but that's a number one agenda item for the Research Misconduct Committee to consider. Am I or am I not an Indian? Which takes us to another story about how this works. See, there's a guy, some of you may recognize his name. The name is John Trudell. Does that have any resonance here? Anybody heard of John Trudell? Well, here's a story of how this works. It centers on John Trudell, and this is pretty much as he told it to me. It's been a while, so I may not have all the footnotes correct. Okay, but John was married to a woman who lived on the Duck Valley Reservation in Nevada. So he was out there, just like me at the time, not enrolled, and he still is not. So I guess technically speaking, under the rules and rubric, the laws, if you will, of the United States, John Trudell, Stone Indian, looked like he stepped off a nickel, isn't, because of course he can't prove it. Well, actually, John can. And here's how John can. And I guess I'm going to get this by way of a standing committee on research in a university. He's actually got a judicial determination. John went to the trading post there in Duck Valley one day, and he discovered that the average price for the commodities on the shelf was about double what they were at the grocery store in town. So he told the guy, being John and all, that I'm going to go home, and when I come back tomorrow, these things are going to be priced the same price here that they would be there. You're going to stop ripping off the people on the reservation. Well, John went back the next day, and of course, prices remained the same. John had a 44 Magnum with him that time. So he wheeled out the piece, and violent soul that he is, shot a can of tomato juice. Tomato juice flying all over the room. All right? The guy's wife freaked out, called the reservation police. They come wheeling up, but John's not from Duck Valley. Uh-oh, we got a big jurisdictional problem. We got a non-reservation resident here, just shot a can of tomato juice. What are we going to do? Well, they called the county sheriff. So the county sheriff came wheeling out, and they arrested John and took him away. Now, they go in for arraignment. John says, you got no jurisdiction. Neither did these cops to arrest me because what I did on an American Indian reservation. Well, they said, sound familiar? Prove it. So why should I have to prove it? Nobody else has to prove who they are. Well, you're an Indian, so you do. Well, he said, look at me. That wasn't good enough. So they finally arrived at what would be, in this neurotic society, an adequate solution. They called a team of physical anthropologists from the University of Nevada. I kid you not. And they came up and they looked at his teeth and they did some cranial measurements and they drew blood and they did a hemoglobin test. And then they submitted a report to the court. And that report is attached to the finding of the court and the physical anthropologists. I think I have this burned into memory. The key phrase in there was Mr. Trudell, well, not as dark as our Indians, must be considered an Indian. Nonetheless, case dismissed. True stories. What kind of a lunatic asylum are we living in here where this is treated credible and newsworthy, an issue for determination by committee in some back room in an institution? I am who my grandmother said I was. I am who my mother said I was. I will be, irrespective of any determination with a committee with which I will not cooperate. It has nothing to do with nothing. We are down to tertiary issues. We've had published now my driving record since 1980. The win-loss record of my high school football team is national news. We didn't do so good. I don't think my classmates are real happy about this at this point, okay? The whole town's probably humiliated. But what are we on about actually? What was the substance of what was said that drove everybody up the wall? I made a comparison of what I called a technocratic core of empire to little Eichmanns. Eichmann, We all know the resonance of the name. Not very many people know very much about the man, what it was that he did. And the first wave of responses I got out of this was, this guy killed Jews. This is a Nazi. Killed Jews. Sorry, he didn't. Adolf Eichmann was brought to a court of law and prosecuted for his crimes, in Israel, no less. With the survivors as witnesses, with the survivors of the victims as his prosecutors, and he was never accused of having killed anyone, Jewish or no. He arranged train schedules. He arranged the shipment of gas from the manufacturing facilities to the annihilation facilities. He arranged the transshipment of the gold pried out of the teeth and the eyeglasses and the clothing and the hair to be utilized in the German economy. He was a consummate organizational genius of a sort, I suppose. Entirely proficient, entirely competent, entirely, as Hannah Arendt put it, banal. As I say, whole book, one phrase. Why Eichmann? Well, I didn't actually say they were Eichmann. I said they were little Eichmanns. Because you see, there actually is a difference here. He was the guy in charge. He was the Gruppenführer. He was not this highly placed Nazi official that they make reference to. He was a colonel, which is a reasonably substantial rank, but not even a general officer. He was an office manager. Important office. It's true. But even in his own context, he was symbolic. Even there, because Eichmann couldn't even arrange the train schedules and the logistics of the Holocaust on his own. Eichmann symbolized all the lesser and unknown figures who worked under him in that bureau. He symbolized the technicians who manufactured the gas. He symbolized the guys in the locomotives who hauled the cars filled with human cargo, the managers in charge of the Buna plant, all those others who were only technicians doing their job in order to fill the proper niche as it was defined in the structure of the society that they inhabited, who turned a blind eye to the carnage they caused, could not have happened without their performing of their functions in the manner they did. Good Germans, but good Germans of a particularly virulent sort, I would suppose. And that was the implication of the phrase, little Eichmann. And I drew some conclusions from that and took the reader along for the ride. Draw your own conclusions. Well, we'll take the ride. But the ride keeps evolving. Keeps evolving. We can localize it here. I've got a couple students live out in this area. We're on spring break at the university, so they're here. Came up to see me before we talk, so I can do some current events. You got a financial district down here in San Francisco. There's places that the people who work in that financial district tend to habituate for social reasons. They go out for a drink or six in their pristine smoke-free environments after work. Sucking diesel fumes as they go. I mean, you gotta choose to live in a smog-infested, I shouldn't insult your city, should I? Well, one of these, and I don't know the name, nobody could remember the name, but, well, I don't know, this does not look like a group that would hang out in these particular locales, but it's possible. You too washed up at the BART station and wanted a beer before you went on, and wandered into a bar that's decorated with Indian motorcycles hanging from the ceiling. Something like 40 Indians is the name of the place. That should be enough of a lead. You can find it. Has a display case inside in which they purport to have memorabilia from Lieutenant Colonel, not General, George Armstrong Custer. Among the memorabilia are human teeth, which are, quote, the teeth of Custer's squaw that he knocked out. Now, I don't know whether they in fact are Manasita's teeth. That's the daughter of Black Kettle that he took as a captive after butchering the Cheyennes at the Washita River in 1868, kept her as a concubine and had a child with her until he was tired of her and detached himself from her. Yeah, you actually got descendants of Custer who are Cheyennes. I don't know if they're enrolled or not, but they would be of that particular union. What kind of a sick fuck would take teeth knocked out of a woman's head after she'd been impounded by one of America's great heroes as his personal sexual property until he discarded her? Who would take pride in that and put it on display as the owner of the establishment? But more to the point, who would habituate the establishment and think that's perfectly fine and acceptable? What's the mentality of people who can turn a blind eye to that or even get a couple of yucks out of it? Because if he was getting any kind of static, given that it's a commercial enterprise, the teeth wouldn't be there. There's no dissonance at all. Eichmann. And it's not something restricted to those Twin Towers. That is Eichmann. That is the mentality of Eichmann. Little Eichmanns, to be sure. Nobody's strutting. Among the several thousand hateful emails I've gotten, some come under pseudonyms. Adolf Eichmann Jr., for example, says they have an issue to take up with me because the people I described as little Eichmanns were not of the same stature. No, perhaps not, but of the same mentality. That is the mentality of Eichmann, and it's here. The Eichmann mentality were the yawns that greeted Madeleine Albright's 1996 concession that the United States, through the imposition of a particularly harsh embargo upon Iraq, was responsible for upwards of 500,000 needless deaths of Iraqi children, just the children, aged 12 and under. 500,000 children had been consumed in 5 years of embargo. Yes, we're aware, she said, and we've determined it was worth the price. What was the price? Someone else's children. 500,000 plus children in a society of 20 million. That, as Dennis Halliday, not Ward Churchill, UN High Commissioner Dennis Halliday, resigned in protest of that particular fact, describing it as the imposition of a policy of deliberate genocide. That's not something I made up. It's not Ward Churchill says. Oh, Charlie left. It's always Ward Churchill says. No, Madeleine Albright said. If you could find out the record of my high school football team, you could probably go back to the UN ambassador and check out whether on a particular program in 1996, it being as obscure as 60 Minutes, in an interview with Leslie Stahl, she actually did confirm that. You could probably even find the UN report. It's not just Churchill asserts, investigative reporters. And then there's this little matter of Palestinian children killed, shot in the head for throwing rocks during the Intifada, which the last I heard was rock throwing was the heavy action, not exactly a violent opposition to the armed occupation of a homeland that had lasted for two generations in the name of securing stability as the U.S. defines it for purposes of sustaining U.S. interests and penetration in that strategically crucial area of the world. Why strategically crucial? Because of the oil that flanks it. There is no oil in Palestine. There is oil in the contiguous areas, and that's the beachhead by which you assert the dominion that's necessary to cause the oil to flow with a certain degree of regularity in the area. These are known facts. These are facts that were ignored by the people who engage in maximization of profit which can occur only on a basis of the sort of stability we're talking about in the quid pro quo. There, of course, is a massive suppression of rights, the immiseration of population, and the mass death, ultimately, of that population in order that you can enjoy a quality of life that means a 26-year-old generates enough revenue that he spends $1.3 million on a loft apartment in Soho District of New York and promptly proceeds to gut the thing, planning to spend $2.7 million more, making a $4 million domicile at age 26, and that being, I'm entitled to it, that mentality, irrespective of how many children have to starve in order to provide me the revenue based upon the profit maximization to live in this particular manner. When you are engaged in that, you are not especially different in your mentality and the acceptance of carnage. Ultimately, we will have these protestations that we don't agree with the policy, we detest the policy. I didn't vote for Bush, I'd vote for Kerry instead. Okay. I'm not a Republican, I'm a Democratican. I'm voting for the lesser of evils here. Hot newsflash, people. The lesser of evils is evil. When you vote for evil, in full knowledge, prevaricating, rationalizing, ultimately justifying maintenance of the status quo because it's comfortable, convenient, and ultimately supporting to a privilege that they've either anointed themselves to possess or have been indoctrinated to believe. Either way, the result becomes the same. The master race, the chosen, Ubermensch. I started there because I don't know where you were in the morning of the 11th of September 2001, but I was sitting at a word processor working on an essay on American Indians in film when the phone rang, and a good friend of mine said, "Ari, is your TV on?" And I said, "No." Seldom is, unless there's NFL football so I can watch some serious injuries happen. He said, "Well, turn it on because somebody just flew a plane into the World Trade Center." Took me a hot second to realize this wasn't some kind of joke. And I went in and turned the TV on, watched the second plane come in real time. Watch the buildings come down, too, in real time. Even before the first building came down, it was already being framed and shaped and packaged by the media. Senseless act. And I'm saying to myself, somebody just flew two aircraft, into each of the towers of the World Trade Center. Someone has taken a third aircraft and flown it straight into the Pentagon. And there's a fourth still running around out there someplace. Funny thing about that, the one woman with a cell phone in the lavatory calls her husband, who's a government official, and that's reported in the news, and I don't know what happened to that guy. He's never been heard from again. Okay, because that sounded like a real good idea. The problem was, his story, it was one cell phone, one wife, one set of conversations or communications that ends in a large bang, and there's no more communication. The last thing he ever said, at least publicly, and by nightfall, every passenger in the aircraft has their cell phone out and they're chatting away through the whole hijacking, okay, and they've overpowered people and it crashes into the ground. I don't know. Other than you didn't have much sound reporting on that either. Discrepancies in it are overwhelming. What happened there, I don't know. But what I do know is you had four aircraft that were commandeered, three of which hit targets. And you don't do that without a motive, and if you got a motive, what you've done is not senseless. It's got a purpose. If it's a purpose, you can agree with it or disagree with it, but it's certainly not something you can discard to the realm of the senseless. That was my first response to it, so I started thinking about what the sense might be. What might motivate people? What might their purpose be? And about that time, the phone rang again, and it was the editor of Dark Knight Field Notes saying, "We need a gut response to this, and we need it in time to post it on the web tomorrow." So now we've got shape to how I'm going to go at this motive and purpose business. I'm going to try to explain it first of all to myself. And I started right there, with the Iraqi children and Madeleine Albright's statement and a lack of response, a lack of dissonance in the American public, because I don't remember mass protests about Iraqi children. I don't remember outraged speeches being played on C-SPAN about it. I don't remember any kind of response, particularly in that quarter where the planes were going in. I didn't hear any kind of response or dissent coming out of the Pentagon or the World Trade Center. I didn't hear any from the society as a whole. So it occurred to me maybe somebody was upset about losing 500 plus thousand of their children. It occurred to me maybe somebody was upset about Palestinian kids getting butchered with impunity, and it's always a retaliation. Okay? We're always retaliating for something like the Palestinians invaded. What was it the Palestinians invaded again? Isn't that Palestine? How can you invade somebody's country and always be retaliating against them? I just don't understand the logic of this, but that's a standard framing. Maybe somebody had just had enough of it. Maybe, like Malcolm said, it was a chickens coming home to roost. But how do you liken these chickens? And how do you tie it to the 500,000? Well, let's say the chickens might be likened to ghosts or wraiths or spirits or ancestors. Call them what you will, whatever your tradition may be. It's fine. So there's 500,000 youthful Iraqi children's, youthful Iraqi chickens or ghosts sitting on those wings of those aircraft as they're coming in. An untold number of thousands of Palestinian children as well. Probably the Iraqi adults, and that'd be another 500,000. How about 3 million Indochinese? How about those people at Nogunri, Korea? The United States' enforcement of another partition of someone else's country in the name of freedom. Prevent them from reimposing themselves upon their own country, massacre them and dump the bodies in a well, in a mine shaft, under a bridge, because Nogunri was just one of many massacres that occurred in Korea. And how about those people that were incinerated in Hiroshima and Nagasaki? Not to win a war and save lives, but to send a message prefiguring what George Bush said in 1991, that what the world needs to understand as a result of Gulf War I is that what we say goes. Isn't that what Harry Truman was saying when the bombs dropped? Send a message to Joe Stalin. What you need to understand is what we say goes, because we got weapons that you can't counter. And here's our demonstration and display. That's a couple hundred thousand people again. But that ain't the half of it. In Japan, they were out in Utah and Nevada constructing simulations of Japanese cities out of wood and paper, checking out incendiary devices under wind conditions to figure out what the maximum burn rates would be so that they could take out entire square miles. That's what LeMay was doing with the B-29s and those 5,000-foot elevation raids with mass incendiary bombing. You had people who were orchestrating that campaign who wanted to kill every single Japanese and said so. They weren't removed from their positions. They were given license to come as close as they could. What, 120,000 people in Tokyo in the Great Fire Raid in one night alone? And you had something like 150 Japanese cities subjected to this. You know what the body count would be on that? And these were intentionally civilian targets. Eradicate the civilian population. Maybe those ghosts were there too. We can roll it back. Maybe there were a few chickens, ghosts, wraiths, whatever, from the Philippines, the turn of the century, when the United States went in to liberate those islands from the Spanish Empire in order to convert the Philippines into a colony for forward basing strategic interest in the far side of the Pacific. Minimum estimate I've seen in the fatalities there, 600,000. I've seen estimates that ran as high as 1.5 million. Entire provinces turned into what the commanders in those areas referred to proudly as a howling wilderness. In the Philippines occurred 10 years after Wounded Knee. And that mass grave. A little matter of genocide, I just took pictures of the Einsatz group in operations in Eastern Europe, where they're taking Jewish people and shooting them in the back of the head and dumping them en masse into anti-tank ditches. The Wounded Knee. Pictures that were taken there the day after. Where they're taking those frozen corpses and throwing them into a mass grave where there's 350 bodies. Now, the scale's a little different, but the imagery's virtually the same. Sometimes people get them confused and think what was happening in South Dakota was happening in Eastern Europe and vice versa. And once you get to Wounded Knee, you got an uninterrupted stream of massacres that run back to the Ouachita. I mentioned that one already. That's where Custer took Montecito and her teeth are supposedly in a bar downtown after Custer knocked them out to force compliance to his demands. Slim Buttes, Sapa Creek, Marias River, Horseshoe Bend, Mystic Massacre, all the way back to that little bit of Americana about how the Dutch supposedly came, bought Manhattan Island for a few hundred bucks. Actually, it was less than 100, as I was told when I was in grade school, but of course that was in that little town where they let me pretend to be an Indian, so, you know, you can't really treat that as credible. But a handful of glass beads and trinkets, and they bought the island. It wasn't how it was at all. For the handful of glass beads and trinkets, which are items that they couldn't procure on their own, had a certain exotic interest, they valued them. The Wappingers, as they called them, I can assure you that's not the name that they used for themselves, but that's how they come down to us in history, for those of us who have heard of them at all, by any name. They basically rented a portion at the tip of their island, a portion of land, so that the Dutch could establish trading facilities so that they could have more glass beads and trinkets, steel pots and bladed instruments, and all these things that were being brought on boats that they didn't have on their own and being exchanged for things that they had that the Dutch didn't have, seemed to be mutual interest. The Dutch took that, asserted that it was a bill of sale to the entire island. The Wappingers didn't accept that as being a valid interpretation of anything. It's like you going down and telling your landlord you bought the house because you're in it. Try that one. See how you work out. You want to mobilize a SWAT team in San Francisco, inform your landlord that you own the apartment and you're not moving out. You'll defend it to death. Yeah. You know how that one's going to play. Well, it was working pretty much the same way. That's the natural response. Dutch solved the problem. Put together a little militia group, sent them up the island to deal with the Wappingers, which they did very rapidly. So rapidly they didn't believe that they'd be believed when they came back and reported what they'd done, so they cut the heads off of all the males, at least all the males of consequence, and took them back as proof that they in fact had eradicated the owners of the island. So you all could think it was a matter of glass beads and stupid Indians. And the population was jubilant. So jubilant, they celebrated with a sporting event. Jolly little game of kickball, they used the heads of the Indians as the balls for the contest. And where that particular event occurred was literally the foundations of the World Trade Center, which, as you know, those of you who have been to New York, was situated itself at the base, pretty much at the foot, of something called Wall Street. Wall Street takes its name from the wall of the slave enclosure which fueled the New York economy in the early days. So you got the ghosts of the Wappingers joining all those others we were talking about already. And to that, you need to add the U.S. portion of the continent, its stake in a transatlantic slave trade. Now you got a lot of chickens coming home to roost. And that was a wake-up call. When you match the scale of what we're talking about here against 3,000 innocent Americans. You notice how that became one word? For a little while after 9/11, you had to say it all one word, innocent American. There's no separation there. You cannot be engaged in a process that derives and devolves from what we're talking about as an historical legacy that finds its footing in that Holocaustal horror, a protracted dimension, on the one hand, and generates the kind of carnage on a routine basis that the U.S. projection of power around the world does now, and be innocent at the same time. You can prevaricate, you can rationalize, you can justify, you can do whatever you want, but the one thing you cannot purport to, if you are a conscious being in any sense at all in this country, is innocent. Doesn't mean you're guilty. You're guilty if you're a perpetrator. You're guilty if you're a participant. But that doesn't, if you're not a perpetrator, if you're not a participant, doesn't mean you're innocent. Means you're responsible. Responsible and guilty are two different things. Guilty is the doing. Responsible is the changing. And if you're not harnessed with every fiber of your being to transforming this genocidal process into the opposite of itself, you are guilty by virtue of acquiescence. There are no bleacher seats. We are all beneficiaries. We all pay taxes. We all do what we do that causes this process to work. We have, by way of response, the obligation to absolutely, unequivocally opposing the outcome that is produced. If we are doing less, we've brought it on ourselves. That which you put out will inevitably come back, blow back, is what it's called by Chalmers Johnson. Blowback is a term of the art in the trades of dominating others and using surrogates for that purpose and having those surrogates splatter back on you. Well, that's exactly what happened at 9/11. And my point was, it's going to continue to happen until there is a fundamental change. Not out there somewhere they learn democracy and freedom, right here where we have absence of same in concrete and meaningful terms. How is that going to happen? Well, I opened this portion of the talk with Malcolm. Malcolm X saying, chickens coming home to roost. I'll end it with Malcolm as well. How do we bring about change? Well, first of all, my proposition was law enforcement, obedience to law. The United States being obliged to conform with things like the Geneva Conventions, the Genocide Convention, the laws of aerial warfare, fundamental human rights law, and all the rest as anybody else, and maybe more so because it has more capacity to do damage than any other entity on the planet. But then the question becomes, and this is where Malcolm comes in, how do you force compliance on the part of an absolute renegade outlaw state like the one we inhabit? And his response was, by any means necessary, I guess that would be mine as well. Thank you. So I've never done Q&A this way before. We'll see how it works. Says, can you comment further on the participation, I think, and complicity of all American citizens, not just those working directly for the government or as a part of the war machine? Yeah, I can comment further. Although I think I was commenting in the course of things a bit about these notions of my old buddy John Kerry from VVAW, that sold out son of a bitch, being an alternative. Yeah. It's the pretense, ultimately, that there is some exceptionalist dynamic that pervades the United States, that imbues the United States, that is embraced as much by the purported opposition as by the rank conservatives, America being uniquely noble, uniquely enlightened. As W. put it, there's now one model for the world to follow, and it's us. That's American exceptionalism. We've arrived at this exalted position by virtue of never quite clearly defined, but nonetheless discernible set of factors that sets America apart and ultimately above the rest of humanity. And the opposition plays the same record. All my life, at least since adulthood, I've been participating in movements that call for the United States to be out of somewhere. Out of Vietnam, out of Indochina, out of the Caribbean Basin, out of Central America, out of Southern Africa, out of the Gulf Region, out of. I agree with all that. But it's all symptomatic rather than causal. The one place the United States would need to be out of in its present form would be here. Okay? But the upshot of that is, and some of you old guys in here know this as well as I do, you've been through it too. We're always in solidarity with the NLF. We're in solidarity with the Sandinistas. We're in solidarity with the ANC. We're in solidarity with movements of armed struggle every place in the world except here. Oh, no, not here, not here. Those rules apply everywhere but here, because obviously those rules entail risk, discomfort, sacrifice. Now, here I am advocating everybody go out and be violent. No, I'm not. What I am advocating is doing whatever it is it turns out to be necessary to compel the United States to comport itself in a fashion that is civilized among civilized people so that perhaps babies elsewhere will stop dying. And if that means people got to suffer here a bit, then they brought it on themselves. If you got another alternative, then get it done. It's kind of like what Natsu Saito was saying about everybody. You should have phrased it like this. That's cool. Why don't you go write an essay and publish it someplace and let people read it? The more the merrier, but stop telling me how I should speak while you're not speaking yourself. All right? Stop sitting in bleacher seats, holding prayer vigils, voting for John Kerry, doing petition campaigns, doing everything except actually confronting power in terms that power is unwilling to accept, and reviling and condemning and vilifying those who take the step into direct confrontation in the terms imposed by the state. Simple. If you got another solution, get to it and get it solved. I'll be the happiest guy around. Hey, I'd like to spend some of my life collecting stamps, okay? There's other things I'd rather be doing. But unless you got an answer to the problems that are being addressed by people like the Black Liberation Army, to draw a historical example from the United States, which was one of the most isolated and reviled groups in its lifetime because it was compelling people to confront the inadequacy of their responses to the magnitude of terror that was being imposed by the United States within its own borders. Until you have a solution, all you've got a right to do is support them. There's precious little support then or now. There's not one set of rules, in other words, for the rest of the world, and another set of rules for the United States, either in terms of its status quo, its hegemony, its dominating elites, whatever term you want to use, or its opposition. The rules that make sense there make even more sense here. And if you see it any other way, you're banking on privilege and preserving what it is you purport to oppose. Simple as that. Got 15 of this same question. Okay, so all 15 of you who posed it, How effective do you think the growing movement to kick military recruiters off high school and college campuses, including recent counter-recruitment activities of San Francisco State University students, will be in as a growing force in the anti-war movement? You want the honest answer or the political answer? I got two honest answers. First is, I don't know. I really don't know how effective it's going to be. It's incipient in that sense, in a certain way promising, but it's self-containing and therefore perhaps counterproductive. You got to view it and frame it in the right way, and part of that's in historical context. See, we did this before. And we're pretty damn successful at it in the before part. And I'm not going to mythologize the 60s. The 60s didn't work. I'm still an outgrowth of that. I still remain consistent with it, but I try not to repeat what it was that failed then, okay? We managed to get the CIA, military recruiters, and even ROTC off campus, and that was a gain, but that gain was treated as a victory, and it wasn't. It was a step along a route to victory. You need to keep the thing in perspective. And as to an anti-war movement, I mean, you might as well have an anti-sky movement. You need a little more political focus than that. I oppose bloodshed and suffering. Cool. Makes me a good person, I suppose, but irrespective of whether I'm a good person or a thug you wouldn't want to have lunch with is irrelevant in both counts. The point's to win. Yeah? Opposing war is a platitude. Opposing the concrete ingredients that are localized where you can actually get at them, the component parts of what makes war possible, at least in the sense that I think you're framing it here, that's the kind of political focus you need to adopt. You can get everybody, probably Jerry Falwell, to oppose war. Yeah. So let me know the outcome of you and Jerry's anti-war movement, okay? Now, I'm sounding flip, and I'm not really meaning to be. There's some actual substance in there if you think about it, and that's what I'd like you to do, is think about it. How you take this sentiment, this dynamic, this enthusiasm, and channel it in ways that concretely engage something that you can actually affect change with. Okay? Otherwise, you're going to be another one of those derelict hippies sitting up there in a smoke-free restaurant wondering where your LSD went, okay, who was all about love. I'm in favor of love. Okay? That was not specific to San Francisco State either, because I don't know enough about San Francisco State and what's happened there in recent days to be able to comment. That's a more generic statement. Take it. It's a good start. Take it someplace constructive. Okay. A far cry, admittedly so. Do you see criminal charges against this administration for its current globalization strategy efforts? I don't know whether the question is framed to, do I actually think there's going to be criminal charges brought, or would I like to see criminal charges brought? The answer to the second question, if that's what was intended, is kind of a no-brainer. I mean, I already said, I have these delightful visions. This is what puts me to sleep at night, of Madeleine Albright, Jesse Helms, and Henry Kissinger all in a nice, neat little roll with nooses around their neck and their toes sort of wiggling about that far. And the current crop is amply entitled to the same destiny as far as I'm concerned. Do I think anybody's going to do it? Well, that's an interesting question. Who would be doing it? There's only one possible answer. You. We. Us. And the alternative is not getting done. So now, let me turn the question around. How bad do you want to see that happen? Do another? I agree with your analysis, so this is not a hostile question. Oh, sure. I just want you to be able to get your side of the story out there. You've got 1/10 of a second sound bite and a 30-second news slot. Tell us how you feel. All right. I'll settle down. I was wondering how far you see the little Eichmann analogy extending. To everyone who pays taxes? Those who dine something. Huh? Drive cars? Okay. What about those who resist yet still to a degree have to participate in a system? Well, let's take that backwards. I don't know what set of tactics you got in mind that would allow you to totally disengage from the environment you inhabit while you're engaged in opposition against it, but if you've actually got a formula for this, you come right on up here and clue me in. Okay? This is where we are. You can turn it into a lifestyle thing where you, I don't know, try to subsist on air and wear a gunny sack and, you know. And that becomes your entire preoccupation. And guess what? You just changed nothing. Okay, but you're awful goddamn pure in your nothingness. And it's not about your personal purity. All right? So let's kick that off. If you're actually in resistance, you're engaging targets, and you're probably going to have to be using the tools that are available to you, okay, and you need little things like heat and rent, and oh yeah, if you're going to get anywhere outside your neighborhood, probably a car. Or maybe you're really bourgeois and you're going to have some working class person drive you in a bus. Uh-huh. Let's get sensical. It ain't about personal purity, it's about being effective. Now, one of them that's really driven them up the wall in the clear channel is I told a bunch of self-described black blockers in a bookstore one night, cut your hair, you know, untangle your head from the jewelry, fill in the holes with body putty. Put on some straight-looking clothes so they can't see who you are. Get inside. Bring your weapon to bear. Oh my God, he's advocating people turn themselves into suicide bombers. No, I don't think suicide's a particularly constructive approach. You're probably more useful while you're still breathing in and out regularly, okay? So if you're not going to be doing that, what are you going to do? Haul a mountain howitzer into Wall Street? Dubious. Maybe it's your mind. Maybe it's your ideas. Maybe it's your ability to convince people that there are alternatives and things they ought to be paying attention to, even if only in narrow self-interest. Or maybe it's your capacity to, instead of exercising proficiency of function, fuck things up instead. Yeah. Little Eichmann, I think the choice was just sort of defined in how I framed that out. But as Kathleen Cleaver once put it, and then Eldridge said it in a room kind of like this and got credit for it forever after, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem, right? There's a choice to be made, dear. It's a real choice. It's not a cosmetic choice. I can't make it for you, and I can't tell when you've made it. You can. And you must. You're Eichmann or you're not. Yeah. Can you discuss some current attacks on academia, academics as a result of your situation? Your meaning mine. I.e., is there a current purge of left-leaning academics? No, they're working on it. Okay. And I'm not entirely sure why. I got selected for the particular role. It's not one I chose for myself. Talking about academic freedom and such is not my focus. And frankly, I want to get back. I've been preempted by this for the last several months. It's probably going to go on a little while longer. I want to get back to doing what it is that I do. Because that's a very tactical thing in academia. It's a good springboard, a base, a whatever. But if I was at academia tomorrow, I'd still be doing what I was doing now, because that's what I was doing before I went into academia. Academia is a part of the whole. It's a useful tool, a tactic, a technique, a environment, for lack of a better term. But they made this selection, and while he's extremely ethically impaired, I don't know that you need him a total liar, that he's incapable of telling the truth. Newt Gingrich came on Joe Scarborough and announced the agenda that I was to be. This set of circumstances, the collaboration of the governor and the legislature and the regents, for that matter, in it, were to serve as the focal point for a general rollback of things that he considered to be ideologically suspect. He put it in pretty much those terms. There's no reason to disbelieve him. He was feeling real cocky and confident that night. And I think they felt that I was going to be vulnerable and I'd cave because of my particular background. I don't come from a privileged background. I didn't have a college education and all of that. I'm one of those, what they call them in that book title, Strangers in Paradise, although paradise ain't. And I was looking for a job when I got there, and they miscalculated because they shot from the hip and they moved quick, and I'm not backing up. That's an obligation, too. It's not one that I chose, not one I especially wanted, but that's the way it is, and so they're sort of sticking. But they're changing tactics, trying to reframe the issue in more palatable terms since they broke their teeth on the academic freedom First Amendment thing with regard to me personally, but they also expand it to engage in a more overt tactic on things like ethnic studies, women's studies, queer studies. All these studies are subject to being rebooted. The regents of my own institution have said they want to review the justification for the existence of every single department on campus. They want to review the qualifications of every single faculty member. Well, guess who they're talking about? And I don't know whether they're going to have everybody else trying to prove they are who they say they are. Be real interesting to me. I want all those white male faculty members to have to prove. Same thing I was hitting old Charlie there with a little while ago. They actually are just white. Whatever. So that there's that role. They hit on a guy by the name of Alam in the first couple of weeks of mine. Moment is being, what is it they call that program, the Ward Churchill factor? Yeah. Right up front in that. And there's other people that they've been working on as well. But now it's interesting. I've got this particular set of qualifications to try to make it look like I checked off an affirmative action form and therefore they immediately hired me as a tenured professor. I mean, Jesus Christ, if that was the case, you'd have hundreds of Indians running around the University of Colorado campus. It has something to do with the books. It has something to do with the resonance of the books. It has something to do with the way the books have been received by scholarly peers as well as people. Okay, the kind of endorsements they've got, the kind of introductions they've got, the kind of awards they've received. Now, the awards thing is kind of important, because when Noam Chomsky endorses one of my books, puts a blurb on the back, I know he did it, right? I know who it was, and I know what he said. Howard Zinn writes the intro, I know who it was, and what he said. When you get a writing award for human rights writing or something like that, it's a blind committee. I have no idea who they were. So they can say anything they want without fear of alienating me. That lends a certain greater degree of prestige and stature to the receipt of the award than the endorsement by, no matter how eminent the scholar, endorsement of a scholar, and it's in public fashion. Well, they can't make the awards go away. So they're attacking the Meyer Center now. They're attacking the bestower of the award as being left-leaning and irredeemable. It's that broad. They're looking at rolling up everything to the left of Attila the Hun, converting the university complex in this country to basically a high-level VOTEC, where you go in to be inculcated, and this comes out of Clark Kerr, right across the bay, when he was heading up UCal Berkeley. He wrote a very important book, not much remembered now, but you ought to go down and see if you can find a copy of it, because he laid out the present script pretty clearly, clear back in 1960. He said, students serve as raw material, and you got a workforce, that's a faculty, you got a managerial class, and you got a product that's desired at the end, and that's what you'll get investment of taxpayer money or corporate money to produce. That's the VOTEC model. That's 45 years ago. He had that on the boards. Now, the people who run these institutions aren't real quick studies, fortunately. But that's exactly what they got in mind. You will get skill sets that are desired by corporations inculcated, and you'll get block instruction in ideological perspective on things like history and literature. You will be taught what to think rather than how to think, okay, and you'll be a good, compliant, and very capable workforce. That's the idea. Oh, yes, you'll be imbued with patriotic virtue, too. You'll be a little red, white, and blue cheering section for whatever policy the Newt Gingriches of the world want to put up in front of you. And every night you can get your soundbite reinforcements. That's what they got in mind, and they're well on their way. And this is part of the whole. So it's not about Ward Churchill, other than, like Eichmann, I'm a symbol. Much bigger set of stakes involved here. If you defend on the issue. Oh my God, it's going to take me all night to read the question. You connect the 9-1-1 attacks to an historical accumulation of pretty good motives for attacking targets in the U.S. But don't you think this gives bin Laden too much credit? No. For myself, the attacks do not embody the collective gross response of all who may have reason to push back. Well, probably not. No, I think the attacks were complicit with the project of the technocrats, big Eichmanns and little Eichmanns that you speak of, and do not in any way reflect the political will or strategic interests of those who have been living, and in parentheses, dying in the teeth of an American empire. Please respond. Well, that's what I'm doing. Nothing anybody ever does. I really don't want to rain on anybody's parade here. But nothing anybody ever does represents everybody else as you can define them by group. We are human, we are imperfect, we respond honestly or we do not, and there's varying degrees of honesty. Complicity of bin Laden with the technocrats, which is getting real close to what I understand, 6 in every 10 New Yorkers now believe that it wasn't bin Laden at all. It wasn't Arabs at all. It was actually the government doing a Reichstag fire kind of thing. I wouldn't rule this out. But I wouldn't rule it out. It's not beyond our capacity. But until I have concrete evidence that that's the case, I am not going to assign the responsibility for it to some smarter white man disempowering brown people from being able to respond at all. Every time that blood is drawn on the empire, there has to have been a malevolent genius of a white man behind it, because the wogs couldn't think this up and carry it out on their own. And that's Kipling speak. When you got something concrete that tells me that George Bush, in collaboration with somebody else and somebody else and somebody else in the Chase Manhattan Bank, did this for reasons that are, well, they wanted the buildings to come down anyway, and that might be true. Bring it. But until then, that's just another white fantasy, imperial game, dominant. What Eldridge used to call the omnipotent administrator asserting himself over the super masculine menial. Because all the brown people are bodies, and all the white people are is minds. Scary business when you think about it that way now, isn't it? And it's so easy to fall into. So easy. But it just replicates that which is wrong and to be opposed. Is capitalism bad? And what would be your alternative? Okay, you heard it here first. Capitalism is bad. And my first alternative would be to have no capitalism. My second alternative might be to suggest drawing on some viable models that have been sustained over thousands of years outside of this Eurocentric paradigm of alternatives where you get Tweedledee or Tweedledum. Okay, we get capitalism, or we can have the Marxian alternative, which takes capitalism as the absolute required precondition. Yo, how about if you want not to be in that box at all? I'm seeing the alternative that's framed on the foundation of that which it opposes, and it's not particularly appealing to me. It's just not appealing to me. And I don't know too many people personally that it appeals to. So maybe we ought to try something different. Not new. Maybe we could look around and see if there's something that's held up the test of time. And not necessarily hold that there has to be some genius white guy who thought it up. Just a suggestion. Okay. We all know the dire state we're in. I wish we did all know that. So what are some effective ways to change our condition? Let's talk about situations. What can be done to change things? Judging from the fact that you were able to formulate the question, I suggest you're probably endowed with intellect and imagination and a capacity to think for yourself. And the first thing we might do is stop asking what it is that can be done and start doing some of it. All right? And I don't want to extrapolate too radically off of the forming of a simple question, but that's the kind of question I never get when I speak in the third world. Ever. Question between two concrete choices, which do you think would be most effective? And I usually say I don't know because I don't live here. Okay, but talk to me about it, and maybe we can arrive at a general understanding of something. But it's only when I'm speaking in the belly of the beast with relatively affluent, privileged people who have resources beyond the wildest imaginings of third worlders that I find this ubiquitous sense of disempowerment. What can I possibly do? You got so many potential points of attack that you probably need to do a little shorthand with deciding what you're going to move on first by, I don't know, blindfold yourself, use a dartboard, okay, and throw, okay, make that your choice of point of focus, and then do something about it. You might want to keep them things that are on the dartboard that you might hit a little simpler than abolish capitalism, transform, you know. Bring it down a little bit to something you might actually be able to concretely engage in. Better yet, something you might be able to win. And in the example of your having won something, no matter how small, empower others, okay? So that they might want to organize and you can take on a bigger target. And from empowerment in that sense comes something that's much more important than empowerment, which is a personalized deal, power, and that's a collective thing. And power is what it's about. The object is to start somewhere, do something, and ultimately tie it into other things that are in common so that you build this, we use this word, but seldom understanding what it means, movement that can actually exercise power and affect some change. But you start with yourself. It's gut check time. What can you do? I can't tell you. I don't know you. I don't know your aptitudes. I don't know your inclinations. There's a lot about you, like everything, that I don't know, so how can I possibly provide you with a prescription of what you would do to affect change? Do your self-assessment, do your gut check, but most of all, get off your butt and do something. Get organized. Can you speak about some of the forces that keep your spirit going amongst so much negativity and all-out bad shit going on? What gets you up in the morning? Usually a desire to urinate. Not always, but that would be proportionally the greatest, okay? When you do this work, what do you expect? You know? It's struggle. It's a form of combat. If those guys weren't who we thought they were, and that's a pretty evil picture, there wouldn't be any reason to fight them. So you know that if you actually are having any effect at all, you're going to generate negative response. You can consider it validating. It gets to be grueling, I'll say that. In the last 2 months, really have been. I've been here for a long time, but never at this particular level with this intensity. And they take you in shifts. I got 6,000 emails. I hate email. Okay? You realize that's a whole month of time that's tied up in trying to figure out what to do with these things? Just that. And they organize and they generate these things, and you never know which one of them's of substance and which one's eat shit and die, motherfucker. Okay? And I probably got 200 of those. That's exactly what they say. Really literate crowd you're dealing with there. Analyzing the spin, the slant, the approach to this is not by way of complaint. It was anticipated. It's validating in a sense that if they generate this much at you, they're considering you to have been effective in a certain sense. That's personally validating, but it also can be collectively validating if it's appreciated for what it is. The lessons can be learned from this. Like I said, it's not about me personally. Bill O'Reilly doesn't know me at all. Doesn't care a damn thing one way or the other about me. It's an issue-oriented thing. I'm a symbol. I'm a prop. You see what they're doing. You learn. You learn tactics and techniques, I suppose, to respond, to counter, but also to sort of prepare yourself for being in some sort of a comparable situation. That's a good learning experience. I've learned a lot in the last 60 days. Most of it confirming things I already believe, but there's some new twists and turns to it as well. In a certain sense, this is unprecedented. You got to look for McCarthy, that era, to find counterparts, but they didn't have the capacity to provide this kind of focus during the McCarthy era. There's really no precedent for it. We need to learn from it. I say we. Me learning is one thing. Us learning is another, and the us is far more important than me, and you probably derive lessons from this if you understand, see it clearly, that go beyond my own particular comprehension, because I'm too close, too personal, and often too fatigued to learn what I need to learn or what could be learned from it. So it's a collective effort. And I put that out to some of the journalists in the room too, the participants in the slant. You know when you got 50 affirmative things there and you're quoting three incessantly in order to make a negative case what you're doing. Learn from it. And see if you can recover some of your own sense of personal integrity rather than mission accomplishment. How many more we got? For sure? It actually is. Saved the best for last, did you? Okay. Is George Bush a big Eichmann? No, he's not. Eichmann was competent. But there's a lot of Eichmanns and little Eichmanns clustering around and using the boy for all he's worth, and that's his value to the system. Okay? You can't personalize it in that sense. As I said, Eichmann is an individual personalized as Arendt discovered when she went to Jerusalem to observe his trial. She went expecting. He epitomized evil to her. I mean, good God, this was 15 years after the end. Second World War. Auschwitz had been closed 15 years. They were still finding and burying bodies. He epitomized evil to her. She went expecting to encounter a monster. She instead encountered a mouse, an absolute nondescript non-entity, really. And that, she said, was the true horror. Not because he was the Nazi technocrat who performed the logistical functions that made the Holocaust effective and efficient as it was, but because in his banality, his everyman signature, it meant anybody could be Eichmann. That's the frightening part. So don't personalize. Understand the dynamics for what they are. Dacus.
Ward Churchill is a professor in the Department of Ethnic Studies at the University of Colorado at Boulder. On the Justice of Roosting Chickens is published by AK Press. For more information, visit akpress.org.